tonight. A leaked Northern Health memo has prompted MLA Shirley Bond to accuse the government of creating a free-for-all for drug use in BC hospitals. Plus, with spring underway, golf courses are preparing for the season ahead, and some have already opened their doors. And the Prince George Cougars are heading to the second round of the playoffs. Good evening and thank you for joining us. I'm Adam Burles. Eddie is off tonight. A memo from Northern Health has stirred up a hornet's nest about drug use in hospitals, with BC United's health critic demanding changes to what she calls an experiment in decriminalization. Cheryl Jan reports.
A leaked memo providing direction to nurses blatantly states, and I quote, "With decriminalization, patients can use substances while they are in their hospital rooms," end quote.
It was a hot-button issue in question period where government was taken to task over a memo from Northern Health which cites an increase in admissions of patients with possession of substances and use of substances while in the hospital.
We've been hearing from nurses all across British Columbia that they are facing unbelievable workplace situations, and that includes drug use, the potential that people have weapons in hospitals, and their jobs are tough enough as it is. So if you continue to add additional pressures, like people using illicit drugs in hospitals, that's an enormous problem.
But Health Minister Adrian Dix defended Northern Health and all health authorities, saying security is paramount.
I have visited in the last few months 31 public hospitals, and every one of them I've met with nurses, and every one of them we've addressed issues of code whites and of security for nurses, for health sciences professionals, for healthcare workers. In every one of them, we work together to ensure that people are safer in our public hospitals and in other healthcare facilities.
Shirley Bond says she's met with nurses, some of whom have been kicked, punched, and beaten on the job. She calls the experiment of decriminalization as flawed.
The issue that has emerged in hospitals is that because of decriminalization, certainly policy interpretation is saying that we can't actually stop people from using illicit substances. We can't take them away. It is enormously dangerous for nurses in this province. And so it is our job, it is my job, to speak up fiercely on behalf of nurses to say, unacceptable.
What we've consistently done is work with our healthcare workers, work with their organizations, work with the public to improve healthcare in British Columbia. With respect to nurses, that means working together to support better, safer security in our public hospitals.
Bond says what is missing is treatment in countless communities across the province. Cheryl Jan, CKPG News.
The local branch of the BCSBCA has had a busy year, as was recently reported to council. But that doesn't mean it can take its foot off the gas in its mandate to protect and enhance the quality of life for animals of all kinds.
These little critters are getting face washes as part of what the North Caribou SBCA does every day, the organization recently presented to council.
We are contracted to provide animal kenneling services for them, so they have animal control officers and provide that support to the community. But when they do find stray animals, they're brought to us for housing for the stray hold period, and then if they're not claimed, they continue on their pathway for adoption and things like that through our programs and services.
What many people are unaware of is that the North Caribou SPCA has a food bank, which has a high rate of usage.
Anything that we can't use at the center or anything donated from our corporate partners, we're able to disperse into the community and to ensure that these animals stay with their families. Our food bank, we have five partners in the community. Our largest one is the Salvation Army on 18th Avenue, and they take about 150 kilograms of food a week.
The SPCA works closely with the Spay and Neuter Clinic, which has a small team of five, but last year conducted more than 2,100 surgeries.
They're down there Monday to Friday doing an average of about 10 to 12 surgeries a day, and they're just nonstop. The team, you'll see, it's a little bit busy down at that building from 7 to 8 for surgical drop-off and then for surgical pickup. But other than that, they're in those back rooms, they're in their surgical suite, working hands-on to help us with our mission.
The SPCA cared for more than 1,400 animals last year, including 770 strays. Right now, the SPCA is dealing with nearly 300 cats and kittens from all across the region.
We rely heavily on fosters and volunteers. Our teams take care of them in shelters. And like I've said, we're very lucky to have many locations across the province, so we're able to access our Drive for Lives programs and move them to other locations so we can work together to make sure that they're all cared for.
The SPCA is always looking for donations for such things as flat sheets, food, obviously, used cones, and really any kind of animal supply. Cheryl Jan, CKPG News.
With the weather being as warm and dry as it's been all winter, some golf courses have already opened up. Pine Valley opened last week, and Tommy Osborne has more on what our golf season has in store.
You may have been surprised to see golfers hitting the greens already, as we're not even a full week into April, but the season has already begun. The Pine Valley Golf Center opened on March 29th, which is around 2 weeks earlier than normal.
As far as I know, it's the earliest we've ever been opened. And the greens are perfect and everything, so we said, let's go ahead and do it. And it's pretty ideal for a golf course. It's not too bad. There might be some days where we have to wait for the frost to go off the grounds, but other than that, we're going.
Pine Valley is enjoying the early start just as much as the golfers, if not more so, since it means the course has gotten a head start on sales.
We've had a lot of people phoning saying, when are you guys opening? You know, can we come out golfing? And yeah, we've been busy.
El Nino conditions have been the primary reason we've had such warm weather. And even though that's beginning to tail off, local weather experts expect the condition to remain great for golfing.
I think we'll have a very beautiful summer. Definitely. I mean, El Nino is not going to disappear, too quickly. I think it's still going to have a bit of an influence into the spring, if not summer.
As we get further into the season, Derry believes we could be in for more precipitation, which would also be good news for golfers. We could be in for La Nina conditions in the fall, which would bring more rain, but perhaps even during the summer, it's possible we won't be quite as dry as expected.
I think the main concern for many perhaps golfers would be the presence of wildfire smoke. So if we do have an intense wildfire season as we experienced in 2023, that might make golfing a little bit less enjoyable. So we'll see. Perhaps we'll have just an average precipitation year, and that would obviously be quite good for golfing this summer.
With our conditions and weather looking this nice this early into the golf season, and Derry expecting these conditions to last the entire summer, it means that our golfers here should be enjoying a much earlier and longer golf season than usual, hitting the greens. Tommy Osborne, CKPG News.
The Central BC Railway and Forestry Museum is opening a free exhibit highlighting a local artist's work this Saturday. Jeanette Oristuck's show, Our Own Backyard, features a wide variety of scenes of nature all across our community and province. Her art is heavily inspired by how she feels in nature, so many of her pieces are more abstract or impressionist in nature. Her focus on both local nature and the feelings it invokes means the exhibit will have something for everyone. Whether it's a memory many of us can share in or recognizing a location she's painted, Oristuck's work hopes the audience can relate and connect.
One in particular that I can think of, she really wants to talk about waking up in the middle of the night and needing to use the outhouse while you're camping. And just thinking about when you're a kid, how that looks almost terrifying in the darkness and in the woods and not knowing where you are. And so when you look at the painting, you might not necessarily see that, but she's trying to bring through that emotion. She focuses on trying to depict the emotion that a landscape brings up in her. And so in some ways, this means different textures. It also means sometimes using the materials from that area. There's one that incorporates sand in this show.
The lowest gas price in Prince George as of this morning is $1.649 per litre at Costco. The lowest gas price in BC as of this morning is in Williams Lake at $1.624 per litre. Manitoba currently has the lowest gas prices in the country on average at $1.425 per litre. Meanwhile, BC has an average price of $1.929 per litre.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Try one of our delicious stuffed cheesy breads, paired up with chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
Some big news for the city of Quesnel today, as they are now home They are now the home of the newest junior hockey team, the Quesnel River Rush. The Cooney International Junior Hockey League announced today that the North Okanagan Knights, based in Armstrong, has been sold and relocated to the city just south of Prince George. The sale and move was approved unanimously by the KIJHL's Board of Governors and will take effect immediately. The River Rush will be owned and operated by local businessman Tracy Merrill, who has previously been the principal owner of the Kamloops Storm since 2019. Further details regarding the River Rush franchise will be released in the coming weeks. And sticking with hockey in the city, the Quesnel Kangaroos have announced a new partnership with the Lhtako'diné Nation moving forward. Anthony Correa brings us the details.
The Quesnel Kangaroos have a rich hockey history. Now the hockey club is looking to expand that history, announcing a partnership with the Lhtako'diné Nation.
We just thought that going forward with the hockey club, that not only do we play on the territory of the Lhtako'diné Nation, but we have such a big history, not only again with us, but with the Lhtako'diné, that it only makes sense moving forward that we partner up and just continue to build an even stronger bond together.
When the idea was pitched to the First Nation, it was an open and shut case, as everyone is looking forward to reaping benefits on both sides of this partnership.
It was an easy sell for Lhtako. We're going to be sponsoring a third jersey for the team, as well as buying new helmets for all of the team members. And in return, they're going to spend some time up in our community with our children and youth and promote the game up here, as we're going to be trying to build our own hockey rink up here.
And although specifics are still being laid out on what you might see at a Ruse game this upcoming season, the organization will be sure to have the Lhtako'diné involved.
We are in the works of something with them. We can't really say what it is yet, but we will have more, involvement with them, through intermissions and maybe something outside the arena before our games and stuff like that. So kind of show their culture as well, right? Kind of bringing it into the hockey world.
And according to Chief Clifford, there are no shortage of hockey fans on the territory excited about the future of hockey in Quesnel.
These sort of partnerships build communities. It's not just a relationship. It's the whole community is going to benefit from us. The downtown up here in Red Bluff and the surrounding area, everyone's going to benefit from this.
Good evening again. We're looking at a lot of sunshine coming our way again tomorrow. Our look back on the satellite was a nice one today. You can see the clearing, some high cloud to start, but right through there, the mid-morning kind of time of the day, it looks really good. So lots of sunshine, and we'll see that going into our day tomorrow as well. So here's our future cast. Again, there's not a lot in terms of moisture where we are, at least for into our Friday. You can see some precipitation off towards the east, southern Alberta dealing with a little bit of snow today. We do have another system coming in off the Pacific, hitting the north coast for some of Friday morning and carrying through most of the morning with some showers, but doesn't quite reach us. So there you go. Our Friday looks nice and clear. We're anticipating a fairly decent weekend as well, although there is a system that we're tracking. The timing at this point looks like the later part of the weekend or early next week. So hopefully that is the case and we can get some nice sunshine for at least our Saturday and most of Sunday. Six up in Fort St. John. These are the highs for our Friday, 10 degrees. And again, chillier weather in terms of our overnight lows, especially with some northerly winds really picking up. So tonight it will be chilly and again into tomorrow morning. So not quite up to 10 degrees right off the bat, but as the day goes on, we'll start to see the temperature climb a little bit more. 13 in Kamloops, getting some sunshine back through most of the southern interior, the Okanagan and the south coast. So looking pretty nice to end the work week off. 10 in Mackenzie, 9 in Fort St. James, lots of sunshine across our broadcast region. 12 degrees down through Quesnel. Beautiful day for you tomorrow. A nice day along the west coast. 13 degrees, 2 in Edmonton. And as we talked about just moments ago, some snow down through southern Alberta today. And of course, we're looking at that to move into Edmonton tomorrow. 16 in Regina, Winnipeg as well. Really nice weather. It's been actually quite beautiful throughout the prairies the last few days. Much different story further east, though. Lots of cloud cover. You can see it looks pretty dreary over there. And a lot cooler as well. So a sun cloud mix is what we're anticipating, at least at this point, for the weekend. And again, we're watching that next system that is going to spread some precipitation, but hopefully we'll see some sunshine for most of the weekend. And again, we're leaving a chance here and there for Burns Lake. It's early next week, though, I think that we'll see the bulk of that moving in. Tonight, clear and cold, -9 up to 10 tomorrow. You're going to see some sunny breaks here and there, but the clouds will thicken as the day goes on. Cold and clear tonight in Mackenzie as well, -9 is going to be the overnight low. Up to 10 degrees tomorrow. Sunshine is dominant through your day tomorrow. And then sunshine to start things off on Saturday, followed by the clouds. And then, yes, clouds persisting through Sunday. So quite a dull end to the work week, or the weekend rather, but looking at not a lot in terms of precipitation until we get into Monday. McBride will see cloudy skies tonight, partly sunshine tomorrow. Temperatures bump up just a touch on Saturday and Sunday. And in Quesnel, clear and cold tonight at minus 6, up to 12 tomorrow. 14 Saturday. Friday, Saturday look great. There's the next system that we're watching, so you could have a few rain showers to begin the day on Sunday. And for us as well, Sunday is there is potential to see that rain or rain-snow mix, but more so into Monday. At this point, we're anticipating a mix of sun and cloud for most of the weekend. 10 degrees with plenty of sunshine tomorrow. Again, northerly winds will cool things down tonight to minus 5. With that wind chill, though, feeling a lot cooler, around minus 13 or so. So a chilly start to our Friday as well.
CKPG Sports is delivered by Domino's. Try one of our delicious stuffed cheesy breads paired up with chicken, pizza, pasta, or dessert for just $8.99 per item.
The Prince George Cougars took on the Spokane Chiefs last night, looking to complete the sweep of an opponent in the playoffs for the first time since 2007. And once again, their stars came to play, with the second Cougars goal being a pretty special one. Have a look.
Parasak midpoint, commits a drive, scores! William Katz from the line, sneaks its way through Cowan, and the Cougars strike first in game four. Good traffic in front of the goal. Cougars get a big kill, and Kamitz gets a shot through traffic. Denis, and the puck comes to Oren Strom, centers it. Cohen Zimmer scores! Welcome back, Cohen Zimmer! Cougars lead 2-1! Zimmer sneaks it through the legs of Cowan. He has his first back in the Cougar lineup, and Prince George leads game four. Up the middle, here it comes. Riley Height to Parasek, back in front. Funk scores! Zach Funk, a power play goal, and the Cougars lead 3-1. Third of the series for Zach Funk. Is Parasek able to spot Funk in that left circle? But it starts with Riley Height, who is off the draw. Comes to Canton. He will shoot. It goes wide. The Prince George Cougars advance to round two as they sweep the Spokane Chiefs 4-0.
And joining us to talk a bit more about the Cougars' playoff prospects is Anthony Correa. Anthony, thank you for joining us. So obviously, you brought the Mona Lisa tie out again. It was a pretty good first round for the Prince George Cougars. What were your thoughts on the series? There were some, you know, lopsided moments there in the series. It wasn't a total runaway, was it?
Yeah, nothing short of a masterpiece, though, in my opinion. That's why, you know, we bring Mona out. The Cougars are playing as well as any WHL team. And, yeah, you know, there were some scary moments. Game four, there was a one-goal game. Game three on Spokane, they fought tooth and nail to give the Cougars a scare, but overall, Prince George's offense, just too powerful. I mean, this team can score anywhere. The depth is unreal. I mean, Riley has yet to score in this series, which is absolutely mind-boggling. And yeah, this team has been great all year on the offensive side, and yeah, just kind of outclassed the Spokane Chiefs with their skill. You know, going into it, I thought it would be a lot closer, but they proved me wrong, and thank God they proved me wrong, because, you know, we love to see the Cougars moving on to the next round.
And so now the next round is we're still a bit up in the air. We don't know who they're going to play yet. There's a few possible options here. So what's that looking like? Because a bunch of other series still have to be played out and to their conclusion. So what are we seeing so far in terms of a possible opponent?
Yeah, that's exactly right. That's his WHL playoffs is still going on. I mean, there's a couple teams that have finished their series. Three sweeps in the first round, as you can see on the board right now. Swift Current, Portland, and Prince George, three teams to sweep. Realistically, if you had to order them, it would go Kelowna, Wenatchee, Vancouver. Kelowna's the most likely, Vancouver most unlikely, but Vancouver does have a game on Everett, so, you know, maybe they can pull that out. The Prince George Cougars will be facing the lower seed of the three teams that move on, and so if Everett does win, it will be Everett and Portland, regardless of the matchup there. I think most likely it will be Kelowna, and Kelowna is an interesting one because, you know, these two teams have had a rivalry budding all year. You know, they don't really like each other, so it should be an exciting one. Obviously, still some things to be worked out here, but Kelowna seems the most likely right now.
And Round two starts next week. Tickets are already on sale, aren't they?
Yep, that's the benefit of a sweep. You know that you're going to the next round and you can put your tickets on sale for game one and game two. The benefit of having home ice advantage. Friday, April 12th, Saturday, April 13th. Tickets are on sale. Tickets North. Cougars encouraging people to wear white. They love their whiteouts, so it should be a good one. And if you want to get those tickets, you better get them soon because, you know, they are already. I took a look at the site today. They are quickly getting snapped
tickets
up.
Tickets are going fast.
Yes, so absolutely.
It's going to be an exciting round two regardless. Anthony, thank you so much. NHL action last night as we show you three goals galore in three different types of situations. Anthony Correa presents tonight's CKP3.
We start with a good old Hattie.
Good race, Moore with it for the hat trick. Moore in, shoots, scores! The Raven with the hat trick, Trevor Moore!
Trevor Moore goes 5-hole to secure his second career hat trick against the Seattle Kraken. Cool, calm, and collected. Next, history in the making.
Starts with a face-off win, and the Blues scores! Austin Matthews got another, and now 7 away from 70. Chris, how's that for a shoot-first mentality? That's getting it to the net.
63 goals in a season is a mind-blowing stat. There is no hotter player than Austin Matthews right now on his quest for 70. Finally, sweet revenge.
Hironic trying to keep the puck alive. Canucks changing while controlling in the Arizona and the ice. Hughes with a shot, missed on the short side. Garland scores! The ex-Coyote took that one off the end boards and roofed it. And with a minute 51 to go, Vancouver leads 2-1.
Connor Garland scoring the game winner on his former team, the Arizona Coyotes. Shout out to Quinn Hughes for his immaculate skating to make this happen as the Canucks duo takes top spot in tonight's CKP3.
That's all the time we have tonight. Thanks so much for joining us. Tonight, your last look is some kittens at the North Caribou BC SPCA, and the specialists are cleaning their faces because, as like our very own Eddie Huband, they have a bit of a cold. Thanks again for joining us.